Well, it's a familiar and sobering story, isn't it? And as we continue this Tell Me a Story series, we're going to be unpacking that story a little bit in just a short time. If I haven't met you before, my name is Mike. I'm part of the staff team here at Syndal. Get to be sort of involved overseeing the youth department end of things here. And if this is your first time with us tonight, I really do hope that you are enjoying your time so far and that you enjoy the rest of your time with us this evening. It's great to have you here. I'd love to have a chat with you after the service. But let me tell you a story about something that happened in my life when I was in high school, and it involved a soccer ball. Not this one, but a soccer ball. Now, growing up, my mum had that really good balance of sort of having rules that made sure that we were safe and that we didn't kill each other, but also wasn't like overbearing. She still is a really good mum. One of her rules, though, one of the rules that she gave us was that we weren't allowed to like play cricket or like hit or throw balls in the house or sort of around the outside of the house where there were windows. And one afternoon, me and my brother were playing soccer in the backyard. And we weren't that good at soccer, and so the ball ended up in the front yard. And we walked around together to get it, and I had this brilliant idea of just like, why go back to the backyard? Let's just play soccer in the front yard. And so I was like, Dave, it's my brother, Dave, let's do a penalty shootout right here. The only problem was that we didn't have any goals to use, and so instead I was just like, there's a living room window right there. Let's use that as some goals. And so I got my brother. He was younger than me. So I was just like, Dave, you're goalkeeper. And I got the ball and I put the ball on the ground and I took two steps back and I lined it up. And I ran forward and I kicked it and I connected with it beautifully. And as soon as I hit it, it was as if time just slowed down, and I had a sneaking suspicion that I'd made the wrong decision. The ball went straight towards my brother, which was probably not that good of a kick, but then my brother just stood aside because he was young, didn't want to get hurt, so he just stood aside and he let the ball go right past him. And the ball went straight towards the living room window. And then the ball went straight through the living room window and ended landing in the middle of the living room surrounded by glass. And in that moment, I was gripped by fear, just gripped by fear of the pain that was coming my way, the shame of sort of having to maybe tell people one day about this and as well as the consequences of my wrong decision. Thanks to this, Clay. Good catch. All right. Have you ever made a wrong decision before? Have you ever said something or done something that you automatically regret? Or maybe you've neglected to say something or you've neglected to do something, and by not doing it, you're filled with regret as well. Have you ever broken, betrayed, or belittled someone's heart, their trust, or their character? Have you ever lied? Have you ever broken the law? Have you ever spoken about somebody just assuming that they'd never find out? Have you ever done something that you regret? Have you ever made a wrong decision before? And do you know what it feels like when you realize that you've stuffed up? Do you know that experience that comes when other people realize that you've stuffed up? Do you know what it means or what it feels like to experience that fear of the pain and the shame and the consequences of a wrong decision that you've made before? As we look around the world today, it's really easy to see that the world that we live in is broken, that it is the result of hundreds and thousands and millions of wrong decisions being made each and every single day. We're all complicit in it, I think. All you have to do is turn on the TV and it's really easy to be overwhelmed by the evil, by the suffering, by the injustice that exists in our world today. And as you look at that and you hear stories that can just break your heart, it can be really easy to ask the question, what went wrong? What went wrong with this world? What went wrong within me? What went wrong within me that would cause me to make wrong decisions? What went wrong in the lives of other people to bring them to making wrong decisions which have affected me? What went wrong? And accompanying that question, I think, is another question, the opposite of it, the opposite of what went wrong, is this question, well, what will make it right again? What went wrong and what will make it right? Well, as we continue our series that we've been journeying through, we started last week. We're reading through significant stories that occur in the book of Genesis, which is the first book of the Bible. And if you've grown up in church or if you're familiar with the Christian faith, a lot of these stories you've probably heard as a child, maybe growing up, is similar to what Fiona shared before, or perhaps you've heard about them spoken in church before. It's really easy to have a familiarity with it. But I think that when we read these stories with fresh eyes, these ancient stories, we realize that they have a lot to say. And they go a long way to explaining the world that we live in today. And so we're going to be unpacking a little bit more this story of the fall, this story that occurred in the human origin story as presented in the biblical narrative. And we're going to be going a long way to answering this question. Nikita, can you just change that until I get perfect? We're going to go a long way to asking and answering this question. What is God's response to the wrong decisions that are made in our world today? But before we sort of kick on into this actual passage, would you just first stop and pray with me as we commit this part of the service to God? Would you pray with me? Loving God, we thank you so much for the opportunity that tonight gives us to gather together. We thank you for what has already gone on in the midst of this service so far. And God, I'm asking that as we look at this story, this familiar story, that you would reveal to us all how this story connects with our story. And I'm asking that through it, we may come to a new or fresh understanding of where you are at work in our lives today and at work in this broken world, as you seek and invite us back to you. And I'm asking these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, last week, Bill kicked off this series by unpacking the biblical account of creation, how this earth came to be, as well as the role and responsibility that humankind has in the created order. And we read how God created the world. He created everything within it, and it was good. Like, it was really, really good. And the crowning moment of this process was the creation of humans. And that's where we're introduced to the first characters in the Bible, Adam and Eve. And these humans were created in the image of God, which means that they were created to be a reflection of God's character. And not only that, but they're appointed by God to rule as his representatives in the world that he had made. But God also gave Adam and Eve a choice. God gave them a choice about how they could rule. And that choice is represented by the inclusion in the creation story of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And it's accompanied by this instruction that God gave to Adam and Eve. And this is it right here. God says to them, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die. And this is one of those confusing parts of the Bible. There's a lot that we don't know about this tree, and there's a lot of unanswered questions that we could ask, but we can unpack a little bit about what this tree represents. Because up until this point in the story of the Bible, God has created, God has defined, and God has provided what is good. And so God is the one with the knowledge of good and evil. But this tree represents a choice. Will the humans trust God's definition of good and evil, or will they choose to have a crack at defining good and evil for themselves? And this is where the story that we're looking at today begins. So if you've got your Bibles, if you brought them along, if you just look on your phone or whatever, go to Genesis chapter 3, or you can just look to the screens and it'll be displayed there. But let's begin reading this story again. Now, the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that the Lord God had made. And already, like, the presence of a talking snake threatens to hijack this whole story. There's heaps of differences of thinking around what or who this snake represents. And from our position in history and sort of having the whole Bible compiled together for us, most would identify that this snake represents evil, that it is the Satan or the devil or the cosmic opposition to God. But in this story, as it's written, we're not given any details about this serpent other than the fact that is a creature in rebellion against its creator. Tim Keller, who's a well-known Christian author and preacher, he presents his healthy approach about how to reconcile and deal with, like, the presence of a talking snake in the story by saying these words. He says, Satan is speaking through the serpent, and right away readers say, who is Satan and where did he come from and what's wrong with him and how did he get that way? But this text is about us. It doesn't tell us anything about that. It's here to explain how we got to be the way we are and how we are now. The serpent isn't the object of this story. It isn't the focus of it, but the conversation that it has with Eve and Adam is important. So let's have a look at how this conversation went. The serpent said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, well, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And in this conversation and through it, we see the serpent leading Eve and Adam towards doubt and disobedience. By asking them one question and telling them one lie, the serpent takes the focus of Eve and Adam away from everything that God has provided for them in this garden paradise, and instead emphasizes the one thing that God had instructed them not to do. And by asking them one question and telling them one lie, the serpent leads the conversation with the sole aim of causing Eve and Adam to doubt God's goodness, to get them thinking and questioning and wondering, is God holding something back from me? And as a result of the doubt that was in the mind of Eve and Adam, this is what happens next. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and she ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Do you see it? Doubt leads to disobedience. Originating from the conversation with the serpent, Eve and Adam become mesmerized by the doubt that God is holding something back from them. And driven by a physical hunger and a visual attraction and a desire to become wise as God, Eve and then Adam make a wrong decision. They take the fruit and they eat it. And we get the first biblical example of the concept of sin. Sin is a small world, a small word with big implications. It refers to the desire to call the shots for yourself. It's the breaking of partnering with God in the living of our lives. It's making the wrong decision. Sin is that inward turn of the human heart to do what's good for me and my interests, even if it's at the expense of you and your interests. It's when we make the wrong decision. Sin is when we promote ourselves to the position of God instead of partnering with God and recognizing his authority as creator of all things. It's when we make the wrong decision. And the sad thing about sin is that we make horrible substitutes as God, because we get overwhelmed by the responsibility of defining good and evil and then doing good instead of doing evil. It's a role and a responsibility that only God can or could adequately fulfill, we make the wrong decision. And when it dawns on us that we've made the wrong decision, we experience fear. Fear of the shame and the pain and the consequences of our wrong decision. This is what Adam and Eve experienced immediately after eating the fruit. This is what happened. After eating the fruit, then the eyes of both of them were opened and they realized that they were naked. And so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. And then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees in the garden. After eating the fruit, Adam and Eve lose their innocence and they're gripped by an emotion that is totally new to them. Fear. Fear of the pain and the shame and the consequences of their wrong decision. Instead of finding satisfaction in their achievement of becoming like gods, they're overwhelmed by an unnerving sense of inadequacy and self-consciousness. Fear. Fear of the pain and the shame and the consequences of their wrong decision. And so they attempt to cover their shame with makeshift coverings, and they attempt to avoid the pain and consequences of their wrong decision by hiding from God. But fig leaves don't cover the shame, and it's impossible to hide from God. If you read through to the end of this story, through to the end of Genesis chapter 3, you'll see that Adam and Eve have a direct encounter with God, and instead of owning the wrong decision that they both made, they blame each other, they blame it on the serpent, and they even try to blame it on God. And as a result of their wrong decisions, there's consequences for the man and for the woman and for the serpent, which affect their relationship, the way that they relate to each other, and it also affects the functions of their life. But the worst consequence of their wrong decision is that Adam and Eve experience an alienation and a separation from their Creator. Their relationship with God is fractured in such a way that they can't put it back together on their own. They can't fix it. They have to leave a garden paradise, begin to live life in a hostile and broken world. And they have to live in the knowledge that as a result of their wrong decision, they will eventually die. It's a sad story, isn't it? It's a tragedy. And the confronting thing is that this sad story of Adam and Eve and the wrong decision that they made, it's not just unique to their experience, because their story is our story and their experience is our experience. We don't have to just look at the world around us to know that this is true. We just need to take an honest look under the hood of our own lives. There was a core weakness. There was a thing that led Adam and Eve to doubt and disobey God. And the core weakness was not just unique to them. It's also the core weakness that you and I have as well. It's in me and it's in you and it's in all of us. What is this core weakness of humankind? Well, one Bible teacher, he describes this core weakness as the thing which keeps you from and the thing that causes you to. It's the thing that keeps you from apologizing to someone, even when you realize and recognize that you're wrong. It's the thing that keeps you arguing your point long after you realize that you've got no point at all. It's the thing that keeps you from admitting that you need help, even when you know that you need help. And it's the thing that keeps you from admitting that you need help, even when everybody else around you knows that you need help. It's the thing that keeps you from. And it's the thing that causes you to. It's the thing that causes you to secretly celebrate when others fail. It's the thing that causes you to boast when you succeed by comparing yourself to someone who's just a few steps behind you. It's the thing that causes you to always insist on having the final word. It's the thing that causes you to lie about your past. And it's the thing that causes you to cover your mistakes when you mess it up from time to time. What is this core weakness which keeps us from and causes us to? Well, we can describe it using one word: pride. pride. We're not talking about that I'm proud of my kids, or I'm proud of my job, or I'm proud of my car, or maybe I'm proud of my church. We're not talking about the pride that inspires people to go after great things. We're talking about the pride, that sinister, that divisive kind of pride which leads people away from God and others and leads us into isolation. Can you think of what that pride looks like? Because at the heart of every wrong decision we make is this kind of pride. And it's this kind of pride that led C.S. Lewis, who's another well-known author, to write these words about this kind of pride. This is what he says. The utmost evil is pride. Unchastity, which is a word that we don't use anymore, don't Google it. You're not going to be happy at the result of it. Unchastity, anger, greed, drunkenness, and all of that, I love this picture, are mere flea bites in comparison. Pride leads to every other vice. It is the complete anti-God state of mind. Pride. Pride was what led Adam and Eve to making the first wrong decision in history. And it introduced an epidemic of sin and more wrong decisions which continue to afflict the world that we live in today and continue to affect us as well. Pride. It's the root from where every wrong decision made originates from. And pride is also what fuels our response when we realize that we've made the wrong decision. You know, do you remember the response that Adam and Eve had when they came to this realization that they'd made the wrong decision? We do the exact same thing. We become masters at trying to cover and to hide ourselves. We become masters at trying to deal with our shame and pain. We become masters at trying to hide ourselves from God and from others. And we become masters at trying to mitigate the consequences of our wrong decisions. But just like Adam and Eve discovered, we can't completely cover our shame. We can't hide ourselves away forever. And we can't mitigate all of the consequences of our wrong decisions. What are you trying to cover or hide in the back streets of your life today? Well, the good news is that although we are prone to hiding and covering, God is in the business. He has got history on this, of seeking out those who have made the wrong decision. Tucked within the story that we've been looking at today, it's often easily overlooked because of the tension created by Adam and Eve's wrong decision, is what God does in response. Right after we read that Adam and Eve have attempted to cover themselves and are in the process of hiding from God, this is God's response. But the Lord God called the man, "Where are you?" Where are you? God is seeking for the very people who have separated themselves from him as a result of a wrong decision, as a result of sin. And the question that is going through my mind as I read that passage is, do you really think that God doesn't know where they are? Like, do you think he's actually like, "Adam and Eve, where are you? You're such good hiders." The scholars generally agree that in asking this question, God is asking this question in a gentle tone. He's inviting Adam and Eve to come to him. God, the creator, is now seeking Adam and Eve as God, their redeemer. He's seeking and working to reconcile and reestablish relationship with them. And this doesn't mean that Adam and Eve don't face any of the consequences of their wrong decisions. But as we heard at the very end of that children's story at the start, they are assured of the steadfast and continual love that their God has for them. God was seeking the very people who were hiding from him in the garden. And today, God is doing the exact same thing. God is still seeking those who are hiding from him. In fact, from our position in history, we've got the greatest evidence of the lengths that God would go in order to seek and reconcile and reestablish our relationship with him. Because God so loved us, he entered human history as a human himself, called Jesus. And Jesus lived a life that was unique because he never made a wrong decision. And in an expression of just how far he would go in order to reconcile and reestablish our relationship with him, Jesus would take upon himself the main consequences of all of humanity's wrong decisions, all of humanity's sin. And Jesus did this by dying on a cross and paying the ultimate price of all our wrong decisions, and attached with it, experiencing all of the shame and all of the humiliation attached to all of the wrong decisions that have ever been made and will ever be made. A guy, a church historian called Bruce Shelley, he had this to say about Jesus dying on the cross, this central event to the Christian faith. This is what Bruce writes. Christianity is the only major religion to have as its central event the humiliation of its God. Why would God suffer so much pain and so much shame and so much humiliation? Why would he do it? Because he's seeking after me and he's seeking after you. And so to answer the question that we threw up at the start, what is God's response to the wrong decisions that are made in our world today? Well, he seeks after us, inviting us into a reestablished relationship with him. I've got one more question to ask you tonight. If that's God's response to you, what's your response to him? If that's God's response to you, what's your response to him? In closing, I just want to share with you just a really short prayer, which you can pray as a way to indicate your desire to kickstart a conversation with God and with others on what we've spoken about today. If you're sensing an invitation from God to respond to him in light of everything that we've spoken about tonight, whether it's responding to him about a wrong decision that you made today or a wrong decision that you made this week, or maybe it's a wrong decision that's been reoccurring for the last couple of months, or maybe even it's a wrong decision that you've been hiding and attempting to covering your entire life. If you're sensing that invitation to respond to him tonight, then I would encourage you to reflect on these words and just to consider praying these words as an invitation to conversation, to an ongoing conversation with God and with others. This is the prayer. Loving God, thank you for seeking after me. I choose to respond to you. And so I'm just going to pray now, and there's going to be a space for you to say those words in the middle if you'd like. So would you join with me as we pray? God, as we consider the broken world that we live in, it can be confronting to realize that we contribute to its brokenness through the wrong decisions that we make. And God, like Adam and Eve, we too have broken partnership with you by promoting ourselves to the position of God in our lives. And the effects of this wrong decision impact not only our connection with you, but also our ability to connect with others. But we thank you, God, for seeking after us, inviting us to respond to you. If you'd like to respond to God tonight, well, why don't you just begin the conversation with him by just repeating silently in your minds the prayer that's up on the screen. Loving God, thank you for seeking after me. I choose to respond to you. God, may this prayer be just the starting point of a continuing conversation that we have with you and with others, as you invite us back into relationship in connection with you. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray these words. Amen.